So just a quick note on about Seapine, and then Grant will dive into the Surround release. So here we're focused on providing tools that help organizations deliver high-quality and innovative products to market. Our solutions really excel in the compliance-based and process-driven environments, where end-to-end traceability and process validation are a priority. It's really about giving teams the ability to track change and enforce processes without the manual overhead often associated with those tasks. So the foundation for this is Surround SCM, which handles versioning of source code and manages all of your digital assets. TestTrack product line handles requirements, test cases, defects, feature requests, and other project work items with linking and workflow built in. And then QA Wizard Pro is our automated testing application, giving you the ability to automate functional testing of web and Windows applications, as well as web load testing. And then sitting on top of all of that is the reporting platform, which gives you an integrated view of metrics across the entire project.
All right, my name is Grant Lamy. I'm a product manager on Surround SCM. Today I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the changes, the new features and things that we've added for the 2012 release. The first two is sort of related items. It's called pushed repository and working directory differences. They are features that you use to make the items in Surround match what's on your local working directory. The difference between the two is the push to repository takes your local working directory as the truth that should be in Surround. That means that it will change everything to look exactly like your working directory. Working directory differences, on the other hand, is a little bit different. It lets you choose and gives you more fine-grained control on what you add to Surround, what you check in, what you rename, that sort of thing. The next feature that we have is we're now allowing you to recursively view the history for all files in a repository. This was something that people wanted so that they could select a repository and then see sort of from a high-level view all the different things that have gone on to those files that are in there. We've also improved performance for systems that have thousands of files or many, many, many branches. And we also added IPv6 support. We also added a few features that were requested on the administration front. The first one was we configured server options to be available on an individual mainline basis. Now, in previous releases, you could set server options, but they applied to all different mainlines that you had set up. In this case, in the new release, you can set up things on an individual mainline. It's a lot more fine-grained control. We also added the ability to duplicate and rename security groups. This was another thing the customers asked for, and we have a very fine-grained security setup. You can set up things for different groups and repositories and that sort of thing. And if you wanted to add a new group that was just almost exactly like an existing one, it was kind of a pain to have to go in and check everything again. So now you can duplicate the original and rename it to something new and then make the changes that you want. The final thing is we added and beefed up our integrations. One of our things that we have done for years is try to tie Surround SCM into TestTrack as much as possible. Existing users will know we have attached TestTrack buttons in a lot of places, and we added a couple more in this release. The first one is we can now attach files that are in a label to TestTrack items. And the second one is you can do the same thing for promotes and rebases when you're moving changes between branches up and down. We also added some third-party integrations for Oracle J Developer and Apple Xcode 4.2. And a brand new integration with Team City as well. Finally, we beefed up our integrations with Eclipse, IntelliJ IDEA, NetBeans, and WebStorm to take advantage of 64-bit. So that was just a little bit of an overview. Here's going to take a look real quick at a couple of these features. So here we have Surround, and I'm working on a workspace branch. So this is my own private workspace where I'm doing my work, and I want to see what I have changed versus what's on the server. So now I just select my top-level repository, click Differences. This brings up the Working Directory Differences dialog. I'll click on Recursive so I can see everything. We'll just expand it all. So you'll see some different color codings here and different terminology here and differences. I'm going to walk through a couple of these. Up here in the docs directory, we have this file, which is missing on the server, and this file, which is missing locally. Well, what happened was this got renamed. So what I can do is I can select them both, and then I can resolve the missing. I can rename either my local copy or the server copy, whichever one is the most appropriate. It's the same thing with these. One of the header files got renamed. Now down here, this yellow one, the difference is it says different timestamps. What this means is this has been a code change that I've done locally. You can see that I've actually checked this file out, and this one I just edited without a checkout. That shows you that we can do it both different ways. So these would just be a normal check-in. And then finally, this here shows that I am missing this repository, and I'm missing these two test files completely in Surround. Now this is something that I had a tendency to do a lot. I would make a lot of changes, I'd add some files, I'd check everything in, I'd think I was fine, I'd end up breaking the build because I'd forgotten to add some files. So rather than keep buying donuts for the team because I'd screwed it up, now I can just go here and see that this stuff is missing and I need to do an add. The other thing I wanted to show you was one of our new integration points. So if we go into the labels, you can see I have a couple different labels here. And inside these labels, I have a few files. Very, very standard existing functionality. But what we can do now is we can click on this Attached Test Track button. And then I'll select the files I want to attach. And this brings up a Test Track browser window. Now what this is all of the goodness of Test Track right here inside of Surround. So I can select defects that I want to attach to, I can see their description and summary, I can use the existing filters that are defined in Test Track to cut down this list size, I could add a new defect, I could edit this defect, but even better, I could attach it to test cases and requirements too. So this isn't just one of these deals where you type in fix bug number 5 in the check-in comment, or you have to come up with a specialized string that will be parsed later. You can do all this attaching from right here. That's the end of the demo for Surround. I'm going to kick this over to Paula, and she's going to show you some of the new stuff with Test Track.
Thanks, Grant, and thanks, everybody, for joining us today. I'm really excited with this release of Test Track in particular, 2012. There's one of the features I've been hoping for a little while now that we'd be able to get in. We're going to have in 2012, and I think based on the popularity of this feature from your feedback and feature request, I think it's going to be a popular feature with you guys also. And that's calculated custom fields. So this is pretty much what its name implies. It's a custom field like you're used to. It could be a date, it could be a number, it could be a text string, it could be a list item. But in this case, you get to control the formula, if you will, for what the value of that field will be. So you could add two values together, you can do lookups, you can do scores. And what we will feel that people are really going to be using this for is in a lot of cases we get lots of requests for you to be able to do metrics on your workflow. And so we have standard built-in reports. We have other ways with our reporting platform. There are ways to do your workflow analysis now, but since every customer I've ever talked to has a slightly different, in most cases dramatically different, configuration to their workflow, it's kind of tough to bake things into the product that's going to satisfy everybody's needs. We feel with the calculated custom fields that you have now a simple way to do the custom metrics that you need, so you're looking at the stuff that makes sense to you and you're not being drowned in noise. This is something I'm going to be demoing later, so we'll spend more time on it. One of the things with custom fields is that you need to make sure that what you're adding is what you want your users to be seeing. So also in this release, we added a draft mode to your authoring process for custom fields. So this is going to let you, particularly with the calculated fields, do things before you put them into production. You'll be able to add these fields, you'll be able to test them, you'll be able to make sure that they're doing what you want, and then when the time is right, then you can push them to production. Another popular feature request we've had is to make enhancements to our mechanism to allow you to specify default values for new items. So where this really has a lot of practical application is the use of a template mechanism for providing default values for things like an issue. When you want to make sure that people are following the process you want, that they are making sure they're observing and documenting the issues you need observed, but you don't necessarily want to create a custom field for, say, every question you might be asking somebody. Or say you've got a user story or a requirement, a business requirement that you've defined in the requirements management tool, and you want to give instructions to your users on the best way to make sure that you're adhering to your processes and explaining what's expected of the user. Well, you see this one also. When you duplicate items in TestTrack, you've always been able to automatically link the source and the new item in one action. With this release, we've expanded the available link definitions that you can use in this case. So those links that are defined in a parent-child relationship will be available to you as well, particularly handy when you are breaking down or decomposing one item into related items. Everything I've been talking about up to this point is available in all the TestTrack modules. So whether you're using TestTrack Pro for issue management, TCM for test case management, or RM for requirements management, doesn't matter what license you have, all of these features are available. So I always try to make sure I mention this in these and what's new webinars, because there are a couple of features that we have that are specific to the products, and this next one is one of those. The ability to export the traceability matrix to Excel is a TestTrack RM feature that I'll show you the result. I think there's some very handy reports that you can get out of this, particularly when you want to look at your test case coverage for requirements. That's been a popular request for a built-in report. Let's go on to the TestTrack server. Now, if you are a regular user of TestTrack, you are not really going to notice any difference with these features, other than in some cases you might see some performance enhancements. If you're the person who's responsible for administering TestTrack, who might be doing some occasional upgrades and maintenance, then you're probably going to want to pay attention to these. The big news in 2012 is that we have upgraded our native database to an open source relational database. We're using SQLite. One of the big things this is going to allow you to do is use the native database on a 64-bit platform, which is great if you've got lots and lots and lots of issues. We're talking many, many, many thousands of issues, tens and tens of thousands. This is going to be a good approach for you so you can continue to grow and use TestTrack. Along with the database architecture enhancements that we made, we didn't limit it just to the native database. We made some improvements across the board. One of particular note is if you're a SQL Server database user, you might see project load times improve by a factor of up to 80% in some circumstances. So bottom line, lots of great under-the-covers enhancements to our database persistence mechanisms. Worst case, you'll see no performance changes, but in a lot of cases, you should be seeing some improvements in various areas. Again, if you're an administrator, sometimes you want to look and see more details. We've added some nice logging mechanisms that, if you do run into an issue, will enable you to do some faster diagnosis of what's going on and also allow you to have a great conversation with our support folks to get you going again quickly. Next two items, IPv6 support, IMAP support for email. These are just great enhancements to allow TestTrack to function in more environments, and particularly if you are in an environment where these are important technologies for you, definitely happy to be able to support these now. And last, definitely not least, TestTrack, you'll see with every release, we're going to continue to enhance our integrations, particularly with the rest of the Seapine product family. Grant demonstrated some of the really nice enhancements with the integration between TestTrack and Surround. I'll show you in a few minutes some very snazzy integrations that we've added with Kiwi Wizard Pro. So in this case, if you're a TestTrack TCM user who also has a QA Wizard Pro license, you'll be able to take advantage of these. So enough PowerPoint talking. Let's go to the demo. So let me switch over. And now we're at TestTrack. So you should be seeing my TestTrack issues list. So the first thing I want to draw your attention to is in the upper left-hand corner, there's no more bug icon. We have changed that in this release because over the years I've had lots of conversation with customers, and there's a large number of you guys out there who one of the first things you do with TestTrack project is rename defects, the default name for an issue, to something else. Issue is really popular. CR is another one. Basically something that is just not strictly limited to defect, because frankly most of you are using TestTrack Pro to manage more than just bugs. So we wanted to give you the flexibility. So everybody's going to see the new icon. It's a more generic icon. Hopefully it's going to fit in with whatever you decided you wanted to name your items. But most importantly, if you are using defect or whatever you have named your item, we're not going to change it. So you can go ahead and upgrade. Everything's going to be fine. Nothing's going to break. If you use field codes in your email templates, that's going to continue to function as normal. We're not changing email template codes or field codes or changing the name of the SOAP calls if you happen to be a SOAP developer. So things should go along just fine, but you will see a new, hopefully more useful icon for issues. That said, let's get back to the calculate custom fields. Again, this feature gives users lots of power. You're looking again at my issues list. I'm looking at a metrics tab that I created where I'm being able to observe my days in current state, the number of weeks it took to close, fix count, the number of times somebody tried to fix an issue before it was finally fixed, and a risk score. And these are all custom calculated fields. I can say take this guy and I'm going to say I'm going to fix him. And as soon as I've made this change, notice that this field updates. It's now got a fixed count of 2. It's spent 0 days in its current state because it's now in a new fixed state. So this is all happening. You're able to see what your values are as you're updating them. I can do some edit in place. Let's say my risk score, I've got a mechanism here. Oh, if I have a crash with a data loss, I might want to get things updated, and I'm going to have a new risk score. So that, again, the formula that I'm using for my risk score is something that is completely under your control, what formula makes sense to you. In fact, if I switch over to requirements, here I'm looking at a list of requirements. I have a similar risk score here, but in this case, instead of calculating as a number, I'm going to use the value from a list. So I've got a defined set of list items that represent my risk score, and I'm able to configure it so I'm seeing something that maybe might be more meaningful than a bare number. And again, this is up to you in your organization for what makes sense. So with all of these new things that you can calculate, I mentioned earlier I can calculate obviously numbers, I can pick values from list, I can concatenate text values if I wanted to have a custom tagging mechanism, I can adjust my due dates perhaps based on workflow state. Lots and lots of power for creating these, but since these are all at their heart a custom field, all of these values are able to be used in the built-in report. So you can create list reports that will report on these values, you can look at distribution reports, and in of particular importance and usefulness are our live charts. So the individual calculations for an item will show you the value for that item, but then when it's time, you want to look and you want to aggregate across the items in your project, the live charts become very handy. So in this case, I'm interested in looking at the average fix count for these two products, product B and product APS. And this is able to use the fix count that I calculated and calculate the average over over these two products, and I'm able to see at a glance. I could use this, you know, if I had different releases, I could see, is my fixed count improving? Again, so I just want to make sure, live charts have been in the product for a while, but I just want to make sure that people are aware that they can use the full power of live charts with these new calculated fields. So it's, again, it's a wonderful tool for being able to create your own metrics that are going to be meaningful to you. So let's see quickly, what does it take to actually make these calculated fields? Again, I'm going to my custom fields to edit, because they are at their heart just custom fields. And let's look at maybe one of the simplest cases, weeks to close. So this is, you might wonder, well, where is the programming? Calculated fields at their heart are using a subset of JavaScript, ECMA script. So if you have any familiarity with JavaScript, you'll be able to do some very, very powerful things with the calculated fields. But in a lot of cases, you won't have to even look at a line of code. We've tried to encapsulate the most common use cases for what people want to do and make it so that it's as simple as, in this case, I want to see the difference between these two dates, my issue close date and my issue the date was created. Again, drop-down list, I can pick the relevant dates. That's all it takes for that. I also show the days and current state, which shows a nice special case here where I can actually do differences from the current time between a certain state. So that's going to give you your active, you know, how long from now kind of values. So that's fine, but then let's look at if we were to venture into just a little bit of the formula language, I'm going to look at what I needed to do to calculate that fixed count. Again, it's one line, items.events.count.fix. I could just as easily have, I'm typing events. I have a really handy helper tool for me to see what I'm doing. Let's say I really am interested now in the verify count. That's all it would take for me to be able to create the ability to know how many times I've had to test this before I was able to do it. And again, the key is, you're able to use what makes sense in your workflow and really minimal, if any, programming required. I showed you earlier the risk score that we use for requirements. That's an interesting case where you don't always know what the formula is to calculate some number for risk score type values. A lot of people are more used to a table format. So in this case, I'm able to go through with my two input fields, difficulty and uncertainty, and I just fill in the blanks. Let's say if I have a medium difficulty and I don't have an uncertainty set, maybe I don't want to default to not set. Maybe I want to always say it, that's at least worth low. So I didn't have to rig up some formula that with artificial numbers if I'm able to just sort of read across and encapsulate my business values for this. So again, no programming involved for this. One question I get after I've shown people the ability to do this is, well, that's fine, but you know there is a little bit of programming there, and what happens if I don't get it right? Well, we have built in the ability to test your values. So in this case, I'm going to click my test button. Let's say I could type values in, or I could browse. Let's say I want to just look at my fixed defects, add those, and I'm going to test. And now I'm able to see I'm testing against real data, and I'm not affecting real results. So this lets me have a great way to really validate with real data that my formula is doing what I want it to do. And last thing with the authoring of the fields, risk scores become a really interesting beast to set up for a lot of cases. And I say risk score, some people who are not doing formal risk management also like to use a scoring system for help with their triage process. But particularly if you have lots of issues in your backlog and you want to make sure that things are not falling through the cracks. It's nice sometimes to be able to come up with a score so that you're making sure that you're flagging those things that are important to you. So in this case, I have an arbitrary, I'm interested in multiplying the type times severity times reproduced. Well, these are drop-down fields on my issue. How do I convert these fields that might be, you know, what does it mean to say crash data loss? How does that actually equate to a number? In some calculations, I would actually have to do pretty convoluted, well, if the value equals crash data loss, then I want to use 100 for that value in my formula. Since that's such a common case, we've given you the ability to do the mapping without having to do the programming. So in this case, my type field, I'm seeing all my list items. All I have to do to adjust my formula is right here. I'm just typing in a new value. Sure, 68 is all that different from 70 in this formula, but you have that power to be able to do that. So again, you get to set the values that you need. If you have any that you don't want to set, you can specify a default for them. And that's it. So your formula stays nice and simple, and you're able to do your mapping with your values. If you change the spelling on that list item, your formula is not going to break down the road. So again, one line of formula for quite a lot of power with minimal programming, if any. So, calculated custom fields, my favorite feature, I have to admit, in this whole release. There's so much power there for you to be able to get the metrics that you need. I'm saving out of here. I have the option for recalculating since I made formula changes. Do I want to do this after hours? Do I want to recalculate right now? Or do I want to recalculate as things change? So we can do that. So let's say I want to add a new issue and close this, go to my issue. So I'm adding a new issue. And notice that now I have this blue text in my description field. This is something that I added in my configuration for my default field, my required fields and default value setting. I can type something here. I can put workaround. This is something that I can do with a custom event field. So particularly when people are doing final approval, they might have a checklist of things they want people to consider. It's not worth making separate custom fields for everything, but they do want to be able to make sure that users are getting that reminder and also instructions for what they need. So something that people have been wanting for a while. I'm glad that we've been able to add it in this release. While I'm on this issue, just a feature that we've added that's kind of interesting is the ability in the overview tab to toggle whether or not you want things top, bottom, description, workflow events, or right to left. And that really depends on your monitor size, so it's a nice little usability enhancement. I mentioned for you TestTrack RM users the ability to export the traceability matrix. So you're used to being able to see in the application this exported information where you're seeing literally like a table, you can see what's going on. We also allow you to export the same data in two-column format, which is particularly handy. Like in this case, I have a list of requirements and I want to see at a glance which test cases are associated with it. I'm also flagging these items that are suspect because there was a change. Let's go back to TestTrack. And so last feature I want to show is really fantastic integration with QA Wizard Pro. A lot of you are doing more and more agile development. I have more conversations more frequently with people doing more with exploratory testing. There are a lot of reasons why people, particularly early in their test case authoring phases, might not have very definitive test cases, or they're basically looking for a way to make it faster to write their test cases. So if you also have QA Wizard in addition to TestTrack TCM, you're now able to use QA Wizard to watch you do some testing, and it's going to record your manual test steps for you. So I click the record button, QA Wizard is launched, letting me pick which application I want to run. In this case, I'm picking Bug Reporter, which is a little sample project that mimics a bug reporter. So I'm going to type some summary text here. I'm going to pick a value for type. I'm going to click my summarize button. I'm seeing, I'm going to add a checkpoint. I want to verify, I want to make sure that people are testing, that when summary is clicked, that we're going to see crash, no data loss is the value. And that's it. That's enough for now. I'm going to close this guy out, stop recording, and QA Wizard is writing my test case for me. Here it is. I've got steps. I can add my own comments, my own expected results. Let's say I want to delete a row. So basically, I can edit the steps that I've got. But something very handy that QA Wizard has done for us is added an attachment for all of our steps showing us our application. It's highlighting, here's the field that I need to make sure I'm verifying. Something that I've had a lot of comments about when people are seeing this is they love the fact that if you're using QA Wizard to do this first pass at adding your testing steps for you, your team is beginning to use a common vocabulary and style for writing the test. So maybe you have a large team with folks who haven't been on the team for a while. Maybe you're doing some offshore testing for whatever reason. Or maybe, you know, it just takes too long. You're not the type of person who likes to think in text first. You're more visual. For a lot of reasons, people, I think, are going to see productivity enhancements and also sort of a, you know, the ease of use that comes with, you know, being able to quickly use the same type of language when you're describing your testing scenarios. So I am going to leave it there and transition to Pete Vesislauskas, our senior software engineer with QA Wizard Pro, who's going to pick up where I'm leaving off and showing you some of the exciting new features in QA Wizard Pro. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, everyone. My name is Pete Vasilaskas. I'm an engineer with QA Wizard Pro. I'm going to go over some of the new features in QA Wizard Pro 2012. The first feature I'm going to talk about is stress testing. What stress testing is, it allows you to take your application that you're recording, you're playing back against, and you can do things that you couldn't normally do very easily with a QA test machine. Things like limit the amount of disk space available to your application, or limit the amount of memory that the application sees. So stress testing lets you do these things from QA Wizard and write automated scripts that allow you to test how your application responds in these kind of environments without needing to set up an entire separate machine just to do that one particular test. The next thing we added is Google Chrome support. So this is support for recording scripts and playing back scripts against the Google Chrome browser. Just like with Internet Explorer and Firefox, if you record a script with Google Chrome, you can play it back in Chrome or in Firefox or in IE. Likewise, recording a script in Internet Explorer allows you to play it back in both Internet Explorer, Firefox, and Google Chrome. The next feature is the ability to email results of a run. So if you have a set of automated tests that runs overnight, you can have it set up to email you whether it passes or fails selectively. So you can find out that information before you need to go in and check on it. The last little feature we added was the ability to configure the text view fonts and colors. So some of the comments in particular were difficult to read. Sometimes you want to change it to make everything more legible or to match colors for some other environment. So we added the ability for you to change all of those settings within the script view. The next set of features is a set of integration features. You've already seen some of the ones from Surround to TestTrack and TestTrack to QA Wizard. Likewise, QA Wizard had some integration features added both for TestTrack and Surround. You saw a demonstration of how you can use QA Wizard to record a test case. The inverse of that is you already have a manually written test case and you're interested in recording a turning that into an automated test instead of a manual test. So we have an ability to take that manual test and let you easily record a script to automate it for you. We've also added some enhancements for Surround SCM and other SCM tools. Things like History and Annotate that weren't previously available are now available in QA Wizard. And with that, I'll give a demo of a couple of these features.
So the first one I want to show is that integration feature from TCM to QA Wizard. So if we have a sample test case like this one, from within the steps, we can now take these steps and turn that into a script for us. So if I hit this Create Script button on the steps, it gives me a somewhat modified record dialog that lets me automate the step. So I'm going to select Bug Reporter and hit Record. And here we see we've got the Bug Reporter application, and attached to our recording bar is the steps of the test case. So the test case kind of walks you through what you need to do in the automated test. So we'll enter test into our summary, click Done, select incorrect functionality in a type field, click Done, select no workaround in severity, click Done, click Summarize, and done. And then we can close out of here. Then we save our script. So you can see in this script all of those steps that we had recorded also show up as lines within our recorded automated test. We can switch over to text view and see these lines here too. So as you click done, it kind of knows which test case steps are associated with which actual actions. So the one that said select incorrect functionality is then followed by the combo box that actually does the selection of the incorrect functionality. So it lets you take a manual test case and turn it into an automated script a little bit easier. It also provides a link back to that original test case. The next feature I'd like to show is some of the stress features. So for this example, we're going to record against paint. So in paint, we can put a little scribble on here. And then we're going to click this stress button in the recording bar. And that'll show a little stress dialog that lets you pick what kind of stresses you want to apply to the application. So for example, for the disk drive, we can simulate that drive having a certain amount of space remaining, having no space remaining. We can also simulate that drive as being read-only. If we wanted to stress memory, we could simulate having a certain amount of memory remaining. We could simulate a certain limitation on how much memory the application can allocate at a single time. And our last type of stress is networking. We can completely disable networking for a period of time and re-enable it later. So for this example, I'm just going to simulate drive C as read-only. And we hit OK. And then if we try to save this image and hit save, you can see paint comes back and says, hey, we can't save this file because the disk is write protected. So this lets you automate tests with some of these stresses to allow you to see how your application behaves when under particular scenarios of limited disk space or read-only disks. So in the script, you can see we recorded a pretty normal script and then added this one line. We'll take a look in text view 2 where at this point in the script, it simulates the drive being read-only for the C drive and then continues the script and can check to make sure that dialogues such as the one that says the drive is read-only, we can't save the file, or things like that appear. And those are some of the new features on QA Wizard. So switching back to Grant, give a little talk about some of that new stuff with ALMRP 2012.
Thanks, Pete. This ALMRP is close to my heart as an old database guy. This is our newest product. It was introduced in 2011, so I'm just going to do a quick review of what it is. It's our data warehouse solution that's optimized for reporting on all the Seapine data. So that's all your TestTrack data, all your Surround data, all your QA Wizard Pro data. It imports all of the data from your normal databases into its own database that's been specifically designed for reporting. Everything's been broken out. Everything's been really well documented. It's designed to answer the questions that you might have for your business that might not be easily answerable through the products themselves. So you can create reports that work on metrics or business intelligence rules, that sort of thing. New for 2012, we now support the other 2012 products, so TestTrack and Surround and QA Wizard Pro. We still support, with ALMRP 2012, the TestTrack and Surround 2011 releases as well. We are backwards compatible. We've also added improved management for connections. This is something that we got from our customers. ALMRP tries very hard to not make you know about what database your test track data is in or what database your surround data is in. It automatically sends all that to ALMRP and then he queries directly. The problem was that sometimes different servers that say the ALMRP service was working on didn't have the same permissions to the, say, a SQL server as the test track database did. So the improved management of those connections help you diagnose and fix those problems a little easier. We also added a handful of new sample reports. Some of these reports are reports that came from customers. Some of them are things that we use here in-house. They're meant to be inspiration for you to look at and say, I see how I would do this in a report, and perhaps I can tweak this a little bit and it'll work for my company as well. And with that, that's the end of our new features and products for this release. There's a few more additional resources I wanted to highlight. The first is the Seapine View, which is our main blog. It's at blogs.seapine.com. We add a whole bunch of new information to that all the time, videos, different blog posts, going more in-depth about the different features you've heard today. Be especially on the lookout for anything that I post. It's really good stuff. We also have a request a feature page that you see the link for there. That's where you can, if you have a great idea for something to add to one of our products, that's how to tell us about it. And then we also have the user forums. That's a place where different Seapine users can get together and talk about the different ways that they go about their business, their companies, and maybe you can get some ideas of how you can make our products work better for you.